In this video, we'll break down exactly how to factor polynomial functions so you can spot the roots instantly. Stick around, because by the end, you'll discover a simple trick that makes even tricky quadratics much easier to handle. Let's start by recalling what a polynomial is. A polynomial is an expression consisting of a sum of terms, where each term is a coefficient multiplied by a variable x raised to a non-negative integer power. So, a can be any real number apart from 0, but n only can be a positive integer. You can use this notation, but don't worry about it. I'll give you a simple exercise so you'll understand it better. Of all these functions, which are polynomials and which are not? This wasn't so hard, right? Numbers 2 and 3 are polynomials. The others aren't. Now, let's look at what factoring a function actually is. The goal of factoring is to write a polynomial as a product of simpler polynomials, ideally of degree 1 or 2. We want to do this for a couple of reasons. The main reason is that it will be much easier for us to actually see what's going on. Also, when we factor a function, we will see the zeros or roots more clearly, and this is very handy for us. Factors and roots are connected. Every factor of the form x minus a produces a zero when x equals a. On a graph, these are the exact points where the curve touches or crosses the x-axis, because the function equals zero at these points. In this case, the graph has three different roots. They are minus 2, 0, and 1. So the factors would be x minus minus 2, so x plus 2, x minus 0, so x, and x minus 1. This would be the factored form for this unique function. So when we find the roots of any function, we can make the factored form of that function. This is the most important part of this lesson. So when you understand this, you'll understand everything. So now that we know we need to find the roots of a function to factor it, let's look at how we do it with every type of polynomial. First, let's look at linear functions. These functions are already factored by definition because they only consist of functions with degree 1. So we don't need to do anything more. In some cases, however, we can rewrite linear functions with a little tweak to make it more clear what the root is. When we have, for example, the function y equals 4x plus 8, we can rewrite it to see the root directly. We do this by factoring out the 4, which gives us a form like 4 times x plus 2, making it easy to identify the root as x equals minus 2. Next, we move on to quadratic polynomials, which are second-degree polynomials of the form ax squared plus bx plus c. To factor these over the real numbers, we use the quadratic formula because, again, we want to find the roots of the function. X equals negative b plus or minus the square root of b squared minus 4ac, all divided by 2a. If the expression under the square root is positive, the polynomial has two real roots, which means it can be factored into two linear factors. If the expression under the square root is 0, this actually means that there are two solutions, but they are the same, and we can write it as the square of a linear factor because we have the same factor 2 times. However, if the expression under the square root is negative, there are no real roots and the quadratic cannot be factored over the real numbers. In that case, we write it as an irreducible quadratic factor. This is what we mean when we cannot factor the quadratic in a linear factors over the real numbers because it has no solutions. Now, let's extend this to polynomials of higher degrees. For third-degree polynomials, or cubics, we can often find at least one real root. There's a little trick to find one, and this is how we do it. Let's look at this example. F of x equals x cubed minus 6x squared plus 11x minus 6. Let's look at the constant term minus 6. Now let's list every divisor of minus 6, so plus or minus 1. Plus or minus 2, plus or minus 3, and plus or minus 6. The trick is that at least one of these numbers will be a root of the function. This is called the rational root theorem. Now we just need to test them until we find one. Let's test the number 1. F of 1 equals 0, so we found one already. Now that we know that 1 is a root of the function, we also know that x minus 1 is a factor of the function. Now we can divide the original function by our new factor using Horner's method. How this method precisely works is for another video, but let's quickly calculate the quotient using it. So make a table like this and place 1, our root here. Then we need to place the coefficients of every term next to one another. Then bring down the first number. Then multiply the first number by 1 and place the result above the line under minus 6. Then add the two numbers together and repeat the process. Multiply minus 5 by 1 and place the result under 11. Add the two numbers together and we get 6. Do it one more time. At the end, you should get a remainder of 0 here if you did it right. And this is our quotient. We add the values of x to it like this. The 6 gets no x, minus 5 gets 1x, and 1 gets 2x's. So, our function is equal to our divisor times our quotient. Now you can see that we are left with a quadratic equation, and we simply use the quadratic formula to solve it, and we get the three roots of the original function. We get the two values 2 and 3. So the factored form of our original function is x minus 1 times x minus 2 times x minus 3. This method will work every time and also with equations with a higher degree. Thank you all for watching this video. I would appreciate it if you would like the video and subscribe to the channel. See you next time.